Hare. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Pallava Gidipada Dhari. Jana Pallava Gidipada Dhari. Yasoda Nandana Praja Jana Ranjana. Yasoda Nandana Praja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Chirapana Chari. Jamuna Chirapana Chari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Gopi Jana Pallava Gidipada Dhari. Yasoda Nandana Praja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Chira
Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Bhascha Jadesha Dharine Vanshakalpadrubhyascha Kripasindubhya Evacha Patithanam bhavanibhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hari Hari.
I am most grateful to be with all of you this evening. Translation now.
Simultaneous.
Gotcha.
When Srila Prabhupada departed from Calcutta 50 years ago, it was only himself, his youngest son, and three others who came to the ship Jaladuta. Srila Prabhupada was given, after much struggle, at every step he was being refused permission to leave India and go to America. But he persisted. He didn't have any high connections. He didn't have any money. All the things that people depend upon in order to accomplish great things, he depended only on Krishna and the desire of his spiritual master, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. It was actually years of struggle that he prepared for this. And on Friday, the 13th of August, 1965, here in Calcutta, he boarded Jaladuta, a very old cargo ship. Today, 50 years later, hundreds and hundreds of temples all over the world, hundreds and thousands of dedicated devotees, tens of millions of people whose lives have been touched, over 500 million of his books have been distributed, billions of plates of Krishna's prasad, and just a small little drop from the ocean of people who have been touched by Srila Prabhupada is gathered here to completely overflood this wonderful event tonight, to show our appreciation, to extend our gratitude. 50 years ago, Srila Prabhupada, he left Vrindavan, which he called his home, the rooms of Sri Sri Radha Damodar Temple. He went to Mumbai, and there he literally begged for this passage on a boat to America. It has been described many times over the last few days, but the more we meditate on this, the deeper our appreciation will become. Sumati Maharaji was a very successful, wealthy, experienced, and intelligent lady. And she was genuinely Srila Prabhupada's well-wisher. Srila Prabhupada, before he wanted to go on his journey to America, he wanted to have published 3 volumes of the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. It took years of struggle trying to get paper, trying to get publishers to give not only discounts, but practically do it on where he would pay after he sold them. He had nothing. But with all of his efforts, he could not get the 3rd volume published.
He sat on the steps of Sumati Maharaj's office. And the secretary kept saying, she's busy, she cannot see you. He sat there for 5 or 6 hours until she finally came out of her place and said, what is he doing? Said, he's waiting for you only. He will not leave. So she came to him and he said, please pay for this last volume of Srimad Bhagavatam. And she did. She was his well-wisher. And because she was such a well-wisher, she was an elderly lady. She had been all around the world. She said, Swamiji, you don't want to go to America. No one will listen to you. And you are so old. And it's very cold. And the passage on a ship is very difficult. You will die. Stay here in Mumbai. Preach to myself and all these people here. Go back to Vrindavan. It's the place of Krishna. Because of her affection to Srila Prabhupada, she refused him. Like a mother, she was so worried about him. Although she honored him as a saint. But Srila Prabhupada was so insistent. Now, for most people to really insist on something like this, even when people with wisdom and experience are warning you against something that you have no experience of yourself, it takes a tremendous amount of confidence. Srila Prabhupada understood everything what she was saying. There was truth to it. He was old. He was sickly. The people of the West had no conception of Krishna or bhakti. 38 days on a cargo ship was extremely dangerous. He didn't have money. He didn't know anyone. Why did he insist? He forced her to accept his proposal. That was his faith. That was how he depended on Krishna. That is how he believed that whether he lives or dies, he was going to try to execute the order of his spiritual master. Srila Prabhupada explained to us that when he was studying Bhagavad Gita, particular verse, Vyapashayatmaka Budhir Ekeha Kududandana. Krishna says, those who are on this path must be resolute in purpose and their aim must be one. Srila Prabhupada read in Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's commentary, this means one must make the order of his spiritual master his life and soul. Srila Prabhupada, truly as an acharya, showed us two historical, incredible dimensions, the purport of what that means. She gave him the ticket. She sent a message and said, our next boat going to New York is leaving from Calcutta. Srila Prabhupada took a third class mail train. That's the slowest trains that carry mail. Not email. 1965 kind of mail. Letters and postcards, packages.
Several days on the train, he arrived in Calcutta, from what I have researched, about 2 weeks before Jaladutta was to leave. Now, he was born and raised in Calcutta. It was here at Ultadanga Junction Road that he received the order of his spiritual master, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, to take the message of Lord Chaitanya in the English language all over the world. But he didn't go to any of his old acquaintances. His son, Vrindavan Chandra Day, just the other day told us he stayed in a simple little dharamshala where sadhus stay. And with one man, young man, he met in Lucknow one time, he had him arrange some preaching programs for him in Calcutta. Srila Prabhupada went to Mayapur town, to the Samadhi Mandir of his Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada, and spent the day there, surrendering his heart and praying for his blessings. He stopped in Shantipur, where he was praying for the blessings of Sri Advaita Prabhu. And when asked by the pujari what he was doing, he said, "My guru has sent me on an impossible task to go to the West to spread the message of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I am going in just a few days." Here in Calcutta, his son picked him up in a taxi and brought him to what then was called the King George Dockyards. It's not a place where people board passenger ships. A few years ago, His Holiness Bhakti Charu Maharaj somehow or other forced me to go on a cruise with him. Bhakti Purushottam Swami Maharaj was there, and about 300 devotees. And I had never been on a major ship in my life. I was expecting something like Jaladutta. But there were elevators and marble staircases, and there were restaurants and spas and playrooms, and it was so beautiful. It was really incredible. And I was thinking, I'm doing it because His Holiness Bhakti Charu Maharaj is forcing me to do it, but I'm going to really enjoy this. It was so beautiful, everything, and so many devotees. And then we were sitting for a couple hours, and then there was the horn announcing that the ship was about to move. It went. And the ship immediately started moving. And at that moment, my stomach went. And I was totally seasick. And I was thinking, I'm only a young man compared to Prabhupada. Prabhupada was really seasick. Prabhupada was on the Arabian Sea. There was all sorts of storms. This was a nice day. How many of you have ever been seriously seasick? Please raise your hand. If you see sharks in the ocean when you're seasick, you just want to jump in and donate your body. It's really terrible.
It's as sick as you can be when you're seasick. At least that's how it feels. But Srila Prabhupada was alone on a cargo ship with just a few sailors. When Srila Prabhupada boarded Jaladuta, there was just an old plank that was used just to bring boxes. He had to walk through a warehouse. It was just a little room. And Prabhupada was so grateful. In his diary, he said, the room is so comfortable. He was always seeing Krishna's grace in everything. And at 9 o'clock in the morning, he boarded Jaladuta, and soon after, it moved from the dockyards here in Calcutta. And it stopped somewhere. In Calcutta, even if you're on a ship, there's traffic jams. It stopped for hours and hours and hours and hours and didn't move.
Started moving.
And when it started moving, the next day, September 14th, Srila Prabhupada writes in his diary, seasickness. Now, we read about it, and we think, oh, seasickness. But if you actually have ever really been seasick, and you know there's still 37 days left on this boat, it's a serious experience. He writes about it. Eventually, the Jaladuta came to Ceylon, now Sri Lanka, and it stopped there for a short time, then continued. On September 20th, Jaladuta arrived in Cochin. There it was Janmashtami. It wasn't actually at the port. It was just in the Arabian Sea, just outside Cochin, waiting to get in. And there on the boat, in the middle of the ocean, Srila Prabhupada celebrated Janmashtami. And he said he cooked nice prasad and distributed it, and he gave a lecture to the captain and his wife, Arun Pandya, and some of the sailors, and had kirtan. The next day was his 70th appearance day in the Arabian Sea, just outside of Cochin. The boat ported, it docked there for a short time, and while there, the crates of Srila Prabhupada's books, the Srimad Bhagavatam, about 200 sets, I believe, were put on the boat. Srila Prabhupada felt such confidence. He had his books. He spent years translating, writing commentaries after deep, deep meditation and research from the previous acharyas, and then after years of efforts to get the paper, to get the publishers to agree, and typing it and typesetting it and editing it and proofreading it, everything, and it was all to prepare himself to go to the West. And the books arrived. The Jaladuta continued its journey over the Arabian Sea. On August 23rd, Srila Prabhupada writes in his diary, his health went completely down. not only severe seasickness, which means indescribable nausea and headaches and body pains, but he had two consecutive heart attacks. There were no doctors, no medical help. He was alone in the middle of a sea. He couldn't write anything in his diary except a line for about 1 week. He told us later, some of his devotees, that during that time, after the heart attacks, he had a dream. Because he was on the verge of death and there really wasn't much hope. He still had about 3 weeks to go on the voyage when he had these heart attacks. And the Arabian Sea is considered very mild compared to the Atlantic Ocean, where he was destined to cross. But he told his devotees that Krishna appeared to him in a dream with his incarnations. And Krishna was rowing the boat. And he said, "Do not fear, come with me. I will protect you." Srila Prabhupada had complete confidence. The Jaladuta went through the Suez Canal, through the Middle East, through Europe, near Africa, and eventually came to the Atlantic Ocean. And Srila Prabhupada was warned by the captain and some others that the Atlantic Ocean is the roughest sea to cross. On September 10th, Srila Prabhupada wrote in his diary how at this time the boat is sailing smoothly. And I am feeling so much separation from Vrindavan. And my worshipable deity lords, Radha Govinda, Radha Gopinath, and Radha Damodar. In their separation, my only solace is reading the nectarine teachings and pastimes of Lord Chaitanya from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. I have left Vrindavan on the order of my spiritual master, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada, to take this message all over the world. This was the order of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But I am so unqualified and alone. I am completely depending on their mercy so far from Vrindavan. That was Srila Prabhupada's mood. So many people from India go to America because they want to be in a better place than India. They either want the wealth of America to bring back or they want to live in a place where there's nice roads and nice houses and all of that. Srila Prabhupada, here he is in the Atlantic Ocean in a little ship. Srila Prabhupada said when he was in the Atlantic Ocean, Jaladuta was just a small cargo ship. He said, "I felt like I was in a little matchbox." surrounded by waves in the middle of a vast, practically limitless ocean.
Srila Prabhupada, he loved Vrindavan. That was his home. I remember some years later after this, one of my dear god brothers was with Srila Prabhupada in his brand new quarters in his American headquarters in Los Angeles. And they were very nice. Devotees made it very nice for him. And Srila Prabhupada looked at this devotee and he said, "You see how nice everything is?" He said, "But my heart is yearning and longing to be back in my little rooms at Radhanath Damodar Temple in Vrindavan." He said, "That is my home. That is where I long to be." But he said, "But for me to go back, there would be sense gratification. To be here with all of this is only to fulfill the order of my spiritual master." As Srila Prabhupada was sailing, he expressed in his own words, how he was immersed in deep, deep separation from his home in Vrindavan. On September 13th, he wrote a beautiful poem, a very intimate poem. All of us should study these poems that Srila Prabhupada wrote on Jalatuta. Therein, he's expressing the innocent, natural faith that he had, and expressing his limitless humility and compassion. He's saying that if you want to attain Krishna, just take shelter of Srimati Radharani. My Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, it was his desire that the message of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the holy name of Krishna will be spread throughout the world. It is his desire. It is the prediction of Lord Chaitanya. And by the will of my Guru Maharaj, the holy name of Krishna will be resounded everywhere throughout the world. It will flood the world. He was not seeing anything as his own. He was the instrument. That is pure devotion. He expressed his great, deep feelings of union and separation from Krishna in this beautiful prayer. On the 17th of September, Srila Prabhupada arrived in Boston. Now please understand the risk that he took. He had just sailed 36 days to reach Boston. He had seasickness most of the journey. He had heart attacks. He had all sorts of other inconveniences and difficulties. And the whole time, he was only given sponsorship visa for 1 month in America. Gopal Agarwal sponsored for 1 month. That means he could only get a visa for 1 month.
38 days it took to get to New York. If he had to leave after a month, it would take 38 days to get back. And where was the scope for him at that time to extend his visa? He didn't know about any of these things. It seemed almost for certain he only had 1 month to do everything. But he was willing to take that risk. And when he got to Boston, the immigration came on the ship. And somehow or other, through his desire and his prayer, the heart of that immigration agent in America asked him, how long would you like to stay? And Srila Prabhupada knew he only had a month support. But he wanted to stretch it. He said, 2 months. And he got a 2 month visa.
Arrivo.
And then he went back on the ship after going in Boston for a little while with the captain. And there on the Jaladuta in the Boston Harbor, he wrote Markine Bhagavad Dharma. In many ways, this prayer of Srila Prabhupada is the practical essence of how to follow Bhagavad Gita. It is like the foundation of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, because it reveals Srila Prabhupada's spirit and the spirit that he wants to awaken within each and every one of his followers. Trinadapi suniche nataror ibase hishtuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadahadi. It's one of the supreme most manifestations of the realization of that verse. Srila Prabhupada is crying out to Krishna. He wasn't writing this to be published. He was just writing, it was just between his heart and Krishna. It was confidential, private discussion between a pure devotee and the Supreme Personality of Godhead in prayer. He said, I don't know why you brought me here to this horrible place, completely overwhelmed with the modes of passion and ignorance. I don't have the words to speak. As far as we know, Srila Prabhupada never met an American in his life. I don't know if there's any record that he did until he arrived in America. Will they understand what he says? Where will he stay? What if no one's there to receive him? That was the scenario in which he was writing this poem. He said, you have brought me here, Krishna. Now, if you like, you can speak through me to transform their hearts, to rise them above the modes of passion and ignorance, to bring them to your unalloyed devotional service and make them happy. I am your puppet. As your puppet, Krishna, make me dance the way you want me to dance. And he signed his prayer to Krishna. I have no knowledge. I have no devotion. But you have given me this name, Bhaktivedanta. Now it is, but I have complete faith in the holy name of Krishna. Now it is for you to fulfill the meaning of my name, Bhaktivedanta.
your insignificant beggar, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. From Boston, the Jaladuta, it wasn't a very welcoming situation in America. It got caught in the Atlantic Ocean in massive fog. And 2 days later, finally arrived in New York City. When it arrived in New York, Srila Prabhupada came off the plank of this really old, time-beaten cargo ship, Jaladuta. And later he told his devotees, when I was walking down the plank, I didn't know if anyone was going to be there for me. I didn't know if I should turn right or left. But I knew my books, the Srimad Bhagavatam, were on the ship. And I had my guru's order and the holy name of Krishna. So I had complete confidence. He came off the ship, and a strange man from a company called Traveler Aid, he introduced himself and brought Srila Prabhupada to the Scindia steamship navigation company, to their office, where Srila Prabhupada met one man, I think his name was Mr. Forrester. And Srila Prabhupada asked him, you know, could you reserve me a place on a ship going back to India? Because I only have a short time here. And he gave Prabhupada his contact number and said, contact me and tell me when you want to go and I will arrange. And then Prabhupada was taken to a bus station. And all alone he sat on a bus. First day in America, seeing the roads of America from a Greyhound bus. Through the day, through the night, it's about a 12-hour drive. And he arrived in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He got off the bus, and there was Gopal Agarwal, Prabhupada's friend's son, who was waiting for him. He brought him to Butler, Pennsylvania. He put him in the YMCA hotel. Very cheap place. And every day, Srila Prabhupada would walk from the YMCA hotel about a mile to the little apartment of Gopal Agarwal and his wife, Sally. There Srila Prabhupada would cook. When he first came, he saw the refrigerator was filled with meat and chicken and eggs and fish and all that. He never experienced anything like this before. But he was their guest. And Sally Agarwal explains what a totally gracious, respectful, accommodating, and loving guest Srila Prabhupada was. Our philosophy is param drisva nivartate, that we could give up bad habits by replacing them with good habits. So Srila Prabhupada, he cooked a wonderful feast for the whole family. And they liked it so much. He said, I'll cook for you every day. So then they didn't have to keep all that stuff in the refrigerator anymore. And there was no meat or fish or eggs served in the house the whole time he was there, only because he was cooking for everyone. Wonderful feast. And he explains how he was... Srila Prabhupada tells that you can
understand the content of the entire ocean by studying one drop. So he said he was studying the entire American psychology, consciousness, traditions by studying Sally Agarwal. Now, Sally Agarwal was shocked. Recently, she came to an event with devotees in America, and she explained something I never heard before. It really tells very clearly what the mood was that Prabhupada walked into at Butler, Pennsylvania. Sally said that Mr. Agarwal, her father-in-law, he was regularly asking Gopal, his son, to sponsor different people for business ventures, sadhus who wanted to come, but nobody ever came. So they knew no one would come, but then they got a message. Srila Prabhupada said, I'm on my way. So Sally said, what are we going to do? Gopal said, I don't know. So they arranged a place in the YMCA hotel. He picked him up just to please his father. They didn't know Prabhupada. And when Prabhupada came, Sally never saw anything like this before. He's a sadhu. He has a shaved head. He has tilak. He has saffron robes. He has these shoes that she never saw before. And Butler, Pennsylvania is a very simple kind of, it's a very local small town. They're not accustomed to anything different. So she knew everybody in the whole town is going to be thinking, who is this person? Who is this person? Because this is 1965. Sally Agarwal said that as far as she knew, her husband, Gopal, was the only Indian in the entire state of Pennsylvania in 1965. Just the color of his skin, people were questioning. What to speak of a Swamiji living with them? So she did not want to be harassed by people who were going to be constantly asking, who is your guest? Who is this person? So she called the newspaper. This was her strategy. If the newspaper writes an article about him, then everybody will know who he is, what he's here for, why he's here, and nobody will bother me. That was one of the most historic newspaper articles in the history of Prabhupada's pastimes. In the Butler Eagle, it opened so many doors for him. And Srila Prabhupada was studying what America was like. Many beautiful stories that took place in Butler, Pennsylvania. He spoke at the YMCA. He spoke to the first time to the youth of America at a place called Slippery Rock State College. Now, I don't know how you translate Slippery Rock in Bengali, but it doesn't sound like a very prestigious college. But I remember I went there years later. And I was invited by the same professor, Larson, an American man, that actually invited Prabhupada. And it's a really small little college in a very quiet place. And I spoke in his class, and I remember I said, can you take me everywhere that you were with Prabhupada? He said he spoke at my class, and then he spoke at a Professor Sharma's class, and there were several hours in between. So I walked around and talked to Swamiji all that time. I said, can you take me those places? So he took me to this park in the middle of the campus, and there was this beautiful seat. It actually looked like a Vyasa-san. It was made of stone. And he said, we sat here together for hours. I said, what did you talk about? He said, Swamiji was asking me, what kind of tree is this? And he was pointing to the same tree that Prabhupada pointed to. And I was just looking at that tree, and it was like having darshan. And I told him, this is an oak tree. And Prabhupada said, oh, does it give fruit? And then they just talked about oak trees. And then Srila Prabhupada said, what kind of tree is that? He said, this is an elm tree. And Prabhupada was asking all about that kind of trees. And he was pointing to every tree and asking about the trees. And Professor Larson was just becoming like best friends with him, just telling him about the trees. And he said, my heart just fell in love with him. He was just so gracious. He wanted to know so many things from me about trees. And then he started telling me about trees in Vrindavan. And then he started telling me about what Krishna did at the trees. And then he started telling me his teachings. And he said it was just so beautiful. Srila Prabhupada just completely opened his heart and then spoke to him. And then he said, tell me what... He said, somebody interviewed me for his biography a couple years ago, but I really don't know what's happened since Swamiji left Slippery Rock State College. And I told him a lot of details of temples and all over the world and book distribution and Harinam Sankirtan and Rath Yatras, and because I was there in around 1979 when I was with him. And he looked completely stunned. He actually had tears welling in his eyes. He said, I can't. He said, I believe it, but I can't believe it. When Swamiji was here, he was so simple. He's the simplest man I ever met. And he was so humble. And he was so gracious and kind. I was thinking, he's a great scholar, but I could never think that he could actually organize an international world movement. I told him he did. Srila Prabhupada remained in Butler, Pennsylvania for about 20 days. When he was in Mumbai, he was trying to get some contacts, but he couldn't get any. Besides Gopal and Sally Agarwal, the only contact Prabhupada had in America, he got in Bombay. There was a book publisher who published religious books. His name was Paramananda Mehra. And Prabhupada was asking him, after he got the ticket on Jaladuta, do you know anybody in America? And Mr. Mehra said, I know a little one person who lives in New York City. His name is Dr. Ramamurti Mishra. Srila Prabhupada said, can you write me an introductory letter and an address? And he wrote it. So Prabhupada was carrying a little introductory letter to someone he didn't know and he didn't know anything about. And from Butler, Pennsylvania, he sent the introductory letter with a little letter himself asking if he could come and visit Dr. Mishra and what his mission was. And Dr. Mishra communicated back, yes, please come. So Srila Prabhupada, he had a contact. He didn't know who it was or what was going to happen. And Sally Agarwal and Gopal Agarwal put Prabhupada on a bus. And Sally Agarwal was crying. She was so worried about him. How will he survive in New York City? Where will he get food? Where will he stay? When Srila Prabhupada arrived in New York City, one of the students of Dr. Mishra was at the bus to bring Prabhupada to a big festival. It was an Indian festival. And there he was introduced to Dr. Ramamurti Mishra, who was actually a sannyasi. He was a doctor who made disciples in America and gave up his medical practice and was teaching yoga and Vedanta philosophy. And although he and Srila Prabhupada had very different philosophical understandings, they became such dear, close friends. Dr. Mishra said, soon after Prabhupada came, he became very ill. And he thought he was going to die. But Srila Prabhupada would cook for him every day. And Prabhupada would make him eat at regular times. And he cooked such wonderful prasad. And Dr. Mishra, he said, Prabhupada cooked with such love. He was the very personification, the embodiment of love. And when he offered it to Krishna, it was so surcharged with love. He said, his love and his prasad saved my life. They would have many philosophical disagreements, but ultimately, Srila Prabhupada, his love for the soul of every living being was there at the very core of his mission. I'm going to end because it's time, and I think I'm giving class tomorrow, so I'll continue. But I'm going to just say one little thing. In 1976, in Sri Mayapur Dham, Srila Prabhupada was on a morning walk. And devotees were asking him about when he first came to America in 1965. And Srila Prabhupada said, he was talking about when he was cooking for Dr. Mishra and nursing him back to health. He said, I would cook for Dr. Mishra. He said, we didn't agree philosophically. We would have arguments, we would have debates, but then I would cook for him and we would be friends. He said, after I would make prasad for him, I would take a bath and then we would honor the prasad, we would eat together. And after that, Srila Prabhupada said, I would walk to Fifth Avenue to loiter. Now, loiter means doing nothing. And one of the devotees asked Prabhupada in Mayapur, you know, your loitering was to purify the whole world, something like that. And Prabhupada said, my loitering was to study the Americans. I would just walk up and down Fifth Avenue alone. And I would study the American people. How do they walk? How do they do their shopping? And all of, how do they talk to each other? He was just observing. Because these are the people that his Guru Maharaj wanted him to communicate to. These were the people that he felt such dear compassion in his heart to give them love for God, Krishna consciousness. He said, I was loitering in Fifth Avenue just studying the American people so that I could reach them with this message of Lord Krishna. And one day, a Turkish Jewish person who happened to be a conductor in a New York subway, his name was Mr. Rubin. He happened to see Srila Prabhupada sitting alone on a park bench. And there was no one in all of America that looked like Srila Prabhupada. So Mr. Rubin sat next to him and asked him, what are you doing? Who are you? And Srila Prabhupada, Mr. Rubin said he looked so poor and he looked so alone. But Prabhupada said, I'm not poor. He said, we have. He never said I. He always said we, Mr. Rubin said. He said, we have temples all over the world. So many temples, and each of these temples is filled with devotees, and there are so many books being distributed. And Mr. Rubin asked, but it appears that you're alone. He said, I'm never alone. I'm always with my spiritual master. He said, all of this I am seeing, it is only separated by time. We will continue tomorrow morning. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Thank you very much.